All the participants, good morning to one and all. Honorable dignitary, the speaker, Dr. Sutawane, the coordinator, the co-coordinator, Deepak Sonone sir. We will start this session with Dr. Mukul Sutawane sir's introduction, a brief introduction. Dr. Mukul Sutawane is the professor in Electronics and Telecommunication Department at College of Engineering, Pune, which is popularly known as COEP. With over 30 years of experience in academics, research, and industry, Professor Sutawane is currently Deputy Director at COEP and has handled various responsibilities such as Dean Academics, Dean International Relations, Head of the Department, etc. at COEP previously. His areas of work and interest in teaching and research are statistical and adaptive signal processing, wireless communication and networks, and statistical modeling of data. He has conceived, practiced, and executed and steered many innovative academic experiments in curriculum design and delivery for the students and faculty of his institute, Savitribai Phule Pune University, and other aspiring institutes mentored by him. In the capacity of Principal Investigator of the Center of Excellence in Signal and Image Processing, a World Bank funded project by MHRD Goal under TEQIP, Professor Mukul Sutawane has been associated with the development and conversion of prototypes from mere proof of concept, POC, to transferable technologies. Some of such projects are video stabilization for cell phones, automated inspection system for PCB fault detection, density and direction detection for stampedes, and optimal microphone array for audio beam forming, with handsome number of contributed and cited publications to his credit. He is an applauded resource person in many conferences, workshops, and symposia. So, Professor Mukul Sutawane sir, is recipient of Professor S.V.C. Iyer IET National Award for Excellence in Telecommunication Education. So, obviously, we have such an eminent personality in the form of guest speaker with us. I request Dr. Sutawane sir to please guide the audience, all the participants, all of us. Please, sir.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Anil Patil, Dr. Hevrekar, for again giving me opportunity to interact with my teacher friends. Can I share my screen now?
Yes, sir. Just a minute. Let me this.
Yes, sir. You can.
Okay.
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Okay. Yeah. In a slideshow mode, it is visible, no? So good morning, great morning rather, all audience listeners. It is always a great delight for me to connect with my colleagues, my teachers across country. And this AICT IST FDP gives us an opportunity to really interact with teacher colleagues across the country. But the mode happens to be online, and with online mode we have certain benefits, because anybody without taking any hurdles for travel and etc., they can sit at their own place and just connect online virtually. That happens, and there is no resources required to travel down and to visit another place and arrange for lodging, boarding, food, etc. All the arrangements are reduced. But friends, you must have realized in the last 13-14 months that the situation which pandemic brought to us, this online education, we are forced to, right? We are forced to, and it cannot be as effective as it should be. In-person teaching learning is always more effective. That is my experience. I'm quite an experienced teacher probably compared to many of you. And my experience tells me that this online education is not that effective compared to our in-person, face-to-face kind of physical interaction. So we need students or learners in front of us. That is my humble probably experience, and I'm submitting it to you anyways. But this, we have to surrender to the situation and see to it that we are going to do our best when we deliver online, right? I'll switch off my video now. My face, enough you looked at. And then this is the third season, right? Dr. Yuvrekar, Dr. Patil. It's the third in the series. So AICT, IST are now allowing that the same program should be conducted in series, one after the other. There is season three, I think. I'm delivering the same session on the same topic third time. Okay. Role of curriculum design in quality engineering education. So this is really very much near to the theme of this total FDP as such, very near, because what are innovations are going to do? That innovation starts from curriculum. Okay, for every engineering program to be delivered to the learners by the teachers with the help of management and board of governors and the institute, etc., that is always to be through curriculum. That is my gut feeling always. Okay, that's a firm belief always. And then in affiliated system in which a college is affiliated to university, it is responsibility of university board of studies and academic council to give that college a curriculum. Design of curriculum is a purview, it's a prerogative, it's a right of board of studies. It is then stamped by academic council and then it is published in university website, and then it reaches the hands of teachers and the learners, students, right? Institute or CO, let's say college, doesn't have any authority to tweak with, to change that curriculum. In autonomous colleges, in universities, university departments who have academic autonomy, curriculum design falls in their purview. Is it not? They can play, they can innovate with the curriculum, and then they can really change curriculum as frequently as they want. And therefore, it is quite a liberty or freedom which is delegated to them. In university affiliated colleges, this is not the freedom, right, that we have. And then I always feel that curriculum plays a role in doing some innovations and inventions or discoveries or doing some experimentation in offering quality engineering education to our students. I assume that audience, it is all engineering college teachers. That's why engineering, technology and science teachers in particular. Maybe social sciences, humanities, psychology, communication, I agree. But in all of them are in particular attached to an engineering college kind of structure. Okay. And certain case studies I'm going to present over here. Two case studies I have compiled. I'm going to engage two sessions with you, each of around 90 minutes. I'll stretch beyond 60 minutes and go up to 90 minutes, right? And then today's session and tomorrow, I had to adjust the session. Dr. Yuvrekar was kind enough to get me session tomorrow. So at the same time, we'll be engaging tomorrow also, right? I'll try to give you some interesting piece of information. This piece of information is really interesting. I say there are two case studies. One is AICT model curriculum, which AICT announced in 2018. Another is experiment by COEP. COEP is Autonomous College of Government of Maharashtra from last 16, 17 years. Every 4 years, we revise our curriculum. And we have been really, really innovative, in experimenting with curriculum design, first of all. Because people like me are there in COEP who firmly feel that the quality of engineering education, which we deliver to our students, starts from curriculum design. That is our firm belief. And therefore, institutes which can innovate on curriculum design, first of all, then naturally delivery. And then the third component is examination. On all these fronts, if we remain sincere, we remain honest, we remain faithful, then the quality education is ensured, it is committed, okay? That's my firm belief. With that, I start. Again, a great learning morning to all of you. Let us begin with two nice quotes, okay? And it is always in this such morning wherein we are all in fresh mood to grasp something, it is always nice to onset with a good quote. Couple of quotes I have over here, okay? Mind is not a vessel to be filled, but a fire to be ignited. Teacher has to be always a motivator, okay? Teacher has not to only deliver the syllabus, not only teach technical in the class, not only teach the curriculum content, he or she has to ignite a fire in the mind of the student. This is a very holy, noble task. Every teacher has to be like this, okay? And who gave this nice quote? Plutarch, who was an educationist philosopher, he gave us this quote, that mind is not a vessel to be filled. It's not an empty vessel, just. I should not only keep on pouring the content. Not like it will be a garbage. My student mind is not a trash. Kachrapeti, it's not kachrapeti, right? I don't have to simply fill it as an empty vessel, but I have to ignite the fire in his or her mind so that he'll be always motivated, inspired to learn from me and from many other resources like me. That's the stuff, right? Fire is to be ignited. Is it not? Our Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, late president, great president, also used to say it like this, that youth is to be ignited with the fire. Okay, that must happen. And that fire is to be ignited in brain, head of the learner. That must happen, right? Another quote, a good teacher makes you think even you don't want to. Even when learner student doesn't want to think, a good teacher should motivate them to think. And I have not seen a teacher who claims that he or she is not a good teacher. All of us are good teachers, right? No? All of us are good teachers. By the way, there is no teachers training institute as such available. There is NITTTR, National Institute of Teacher Training, available for us, right? But there is nothing like teaching is an art and science together. It is an instinct. It is an inbuilt kind of a instinct. It automatically comes into me. Okay, are artists born? Are businessmen born? Are entrepreneurs born? Or can they be trained? Can I train teachers? I say have to. I can train the teachers to teach good. But good teachers are also by birth. By instinct, they are like that, right? And good teachers should make the students to think even when they don't want to. I like this quote very much. By Fisher, it was that teaching is all about thinking. I have to instigate thinking in the students, right? My every engaged session, my every session I engage on students, let's say 60 minutes, 90 minutes, 45 minutes, 50 minutes, whatever is my session length. I have to see to it that I instigate, I stimulate thinking in students' mind. That must happen, okay? If I can convert my students into thinkers, okay? I teach them thought provocative, then my teaching is more successful. Rather than only delivering the content, I should see to it that I'm going to deliver the thought to them, right? By the way, all of you know that philosophy is all about thinking. And we are all, majority of you are now doctors of philosophy. Does university give us a degree like doctor of engineering? No. Doctor of science? No. We are all doctors of philosophy. And philosophy is all about thinking, deep thinking. And therefore, PhD degree is not the end of the researching mind. Okay, that's all. With this small preamble, I start with my content. Goal of engineering education, what is it? We are in particular talking of engineering education because we are now today, I'm addressing engineering education crowd. Education is crowd, teachers crowd. It's an engineering education, let's say. And that too for a program. Friends, you know now we are into the OBE era. Outcome-based education has been adopted by our country. And NBA, National Board of Accreditation, gives us accreditation for adopting outcome-based education model. And that model has got some terminology. Institute or colleges, engineering colleges, they offer programs to the students. Electronics and communication is a program. Computer science is a program. Mechanical engineering is a program. Chemical engineering is a program. Industrial engineering is a program. So we always offer an education program to the learners, to the students, to make a choice from, right? So what are the goals of engineering program? We receive a raw student who's a learner who comes from a 12th background, physics, chemistry, mathematics background. There can be some JEE mains. There can be a state entrance level, a test, anything, any test is there. And he or she comes to us through his proper legal admission. Quality of student intake, the score he has in PCM, the score has in a entrance examination, all that is declining year after year, right? The grades, the fancy attraction for engineering program is reducing year after year. That's a tragedy of it, right? We are starving for getting good students to us. Those all golden honeymoon days are gone, right? Many of the institutes are struggling to get good students. Quality is reducing. Student is really raw. And what I have to do? I have to convert that raw student into a competent engineering graduate. Competent. Competency should be demonstrable. He or she should be able to demonstrate the competency so that he or she becomes employable in a job market by the industry. He becomes employable. He or she should be able to pursue higher studies, MTech, MS, MBA, whatever higher studies he wants to pursue. Okay, he should be able to score good in GATE examination, CAT examination, GMAT examination, IELTS examination, GRE, TOEFL examination. That kind of competency I want to build. He should be productive from day one in an industry he joins. He should be professional engineer. He should have all the scientific and technology and engineering skills, theory knowledge and skills with him or her, so that he becomes productive from day one in the industry corporate he joins. That I wish to do. How can I do that as a teacher? Okay, every program has intended objectives, which are known as, in OBE language, known as program education objectives. They are known as goals of the program, right? They are there. And worldwide, there is a resonance, there is a concurrence that every program, every engineering program has program outcomes. Okay, and they are fixed by worldwide authorities, by Washington Accord. Probably you know that. Okay, NBA has accepted those 12 program outcomes, which are known as graduate attributes. Engineering graduate at the end of 4 years after completing the engineering program should visibly demonstrate those outcomes, which are known as program outcomes, right? I'm going to mention some of them over here. How can I do that? How can I develop a competent engineering graduate? How can I develop a professional engineer from a raw student? How can I achieve the demonstrable visible program outcomes to be shown by these people? It is always through my curriculum. Okay, curriculum is to be designed with a precaution, with a motivation, with an inspiration, with a whole lot of religiousness. Religiously, I have to design the curriculum. And curriculum is then delivered through teaching learning process. Teacher teaches, learner learns. At the end of the course, after I taught the course, subject I have taught, laboratory course or theory course or whatever course you have taught, we go for assessment of the course. Okay, we give examination to the student. There can be continuous examinations, continuous evaluation in semester. There can be end semester evaluation. So many examinations you have to give to the students. Students will write them, take them, oral, viva, whatever. Theory, paper, online examination, whatever. Quiz, assignment, whatever you do. That is also integrated part of curriculum. Is it not? So curriculum means it encompasses teaching, learning, examination, teaching, learning, assessment process. Through that process, I can convert a raw student into a competent engineering graduate or a professional engineer who will demonstrate to the world the achieved program outcomes. These are the attributes, graduate attributes, which are showable, demonstrable over there, right? That will happen. What are goals of learning and thus teaching and assessment? What are the goals of learning? Rather, every learning session which a teacher delivers to the learner, okay? At the end of that learning session, a learner should have acquired sufficient new knowledge. Believe me, at the end of every lecture which I engage, at the end of every session which I engage, what should happen? I should be able to impart and learner should be able to acquire new knowledge. Okay, because I'm teaching engineering course, new skills, because engineering is all about learning by doing. Only theory knowledge we don't impart. We impart lab knowledge, hands-on skills, software, hardware, systems, everything we deliver. So skills he or she should learn. And more importantly today, student should also acquire from my behavior in the class, the way I manner in the class, the way I behave in class, the way I communicate in class, the way I stand in a class, the way I produce my board writing, the way I prepare my PPT slides. From that, student should have some attitudinal training, some behavioral training. This is very important today. Students are learners. They grasp from us. We are idols for them. Is it not? Teachers are idols for them and they worship us. And therefore, this new attitudinal behavioral skills are also to be imparted. So every learning course, every learning session, laboratory theory, whatever, elective, whatever course you teach, it is always should be aiming at delivering, imparting knowledge, skill, behavioral training, or attitudinal training through teaching, learning, examination. So there are three corners of the triangle. Okay, there are two triangles I'm showing you. TLA are the three vertices of triangle. Another triangle, KSA, knowledge, skill, attitude, or behavior, whatever. Okay, and I overlay these two triangles. When I overlay two triangles, I get a star. Star has got six vertices, right? I can convert teacher should be a star performer. Then and then only learner, the student will become a star performer, right? So KSA through TLA, this is takeaway from this session. Believe me, I'm going to give you many, many acronyms and short forms, abbreviations, okay? So believe and trust and learn it by heart now. KSA through TLA, every session of mine, all 40 lectures of mine for a particular course, okay? It should deliver knowledge, skill, attitude, training to my students, okay? I have to achieve it through my teaching. Students have to acquire it through learning throughout. And examinations are the numeric indicators of how much I could teach, how much learners could learn. That should happen. Some couple of slides on philosophy of education. Again, I tell you, philosophy means thinking process, thought process. We are doctors of philosophy, and therefore we are now thought tank, think tank. We are thought provoking individuals now. What is education? What is it? What, why, how? Okay. Philosophically, education is that which enlightens mind. Okay. It should always throw some light in my mind. This definition comes from our Veda and Buddha and everybody, right? All those great, great thinkers, philosophers, they told education is that which enlightens our mind. Mind is an invisible organ of the body, is it not? Invisible. I don't know. Mind exists everywhere. Okay, but mind is very complex kind of entity. So it should enlighten mind, enrich mind, enrich heart. Heart is a physical organ. Education should enrich my heart. It should ever stimulate my brain. Brain is physical organ, always provide stimulus, instigation, inspiration to my brain to grasp something new. Okay, more materialistically, if I become more materialistic, education should provide work for hand. Is it not? In a country like ours, which has huge population of youth, every young guy, he goes for education for the purpose of job. It provides work for hands. First, it gets him some money. Okay, he can then take care of himself, of his family, you take a house, take a flat, go for a good kind of well-being, and it ensures well-being. Ensures well-being. Okay. A learner can go good in his life. He can progress in a materialistic way. He can progress. Education also helps transform the raw individual. Education system in, let's say, school education, they get a raw learner. Okay. Student, a very young kid, let's say. And the education helps transformation of the raw individual into cultured individual, responsible individual, accountable individual with a tremendous civic sense, societal sense, and global sense. Each of these word carries a big, big depth meaning. He should be a cultured individual. Culture is all Sanskriti, is it not? Sanskriti. We have to convert an individual into a Susanskrit individual, is it not? Education helps us in doing that. Responsible. I have to be socially responsible and accountable for everything I do, for all my deeds, actions. I should be responsible. I should be accountable socially, in society, in my city, and also nowadays globally. We are a citizen. We are a social entity. We are a global entity also simultaneously. Education all brings that. An uneducated individual may not be responsible, may not be accountable, may not be a good citizen of society and globe. May not be. Okay. This is all formal education should do. Education is formal. Okay. I have senior, junior KG, senior KG, primary education, secondary education, higher secondary education, degree education, diploma education, postgraduate education, PhD education, lifelong education, all formal. I go to school, colleges, universities, and I take formal education. Formal education generally ends with degrees, ends with jobs, ends with well-being, etc., etc. But the informal education keeps on to be there with me throughout my life. The kids learn from their parents first, then brothers, sisters, siblings, relatives, grandparents, friends after all. Okay, everywhere they keep on learning. Experience gives you informal learning, is it not? But the formal learning has got some tangible outcomes, visible outcomes, degree, job, etc., etc. Okay, I can then divide that to primary, secondary, tertiary, undergraduate, postgraduate, PhD, postdoc, whatever. Okay, education can be for masses or for classes. Our government says that primary education, secondary education up to 10th, 12th, it is a right of education to everybody. So up to 12th class, masses should be educated, right? No, but degree education, BA, BCom, BSc, for girls, it is all again masses education. Engineering is still for class, engineering still for class. It is by choice. Engineering education is by choice still today. Therefore, we have entrance examination. Do I have entrance or BA, BSc, BCom? No, but it is masses education, right? Engineering is still considered to be professional education. So it's an education for class by choice. So student write our common entrance examination at state level or JEE Main, JEE Advanced. And then it's a class education, by choice education. Haves and haves not, right? Haves and haves not is those who can afford higher education, technical education, affordability of the education, okay? India is one of the countries where higher and technical education is cheaper. US, Europe, education is very costly. It's a costly affair. We have to think before giving birth to a child and we have to plan for his or her education. Education is costly, certainly. India is one of the countries in which education is an entity or commodity which is cheap. Therefore, in society, we have haves not, socially underprivileged class, economically poorer class, which are haves not, which cannot afford to go for higher education. Free education up to secondary level, higher secondary, it's enough for them. Government gives it free and we cannot afford it. There is class like that. More interestingly, teachers should be focusing upon a class of society, section of society, students who want to do education and who have to do education. Have to do is what? It is choice of the learner to go for education. Okay, most of the developed countries, they give choice to the learner to opt for which branch. Okay, in a country like India, parents force the student, societal forces are there, which make the student to go for engineering, for the job. Student may not have any kind of aptitude to join engineering or to join science, is it not? But it is want to do. They are forced to do that engineering program. Okay, they don't have to do it. So there is a difference. Want to do, have to do, right? Have to do is forcibly they are doing it. Want to do is by their choice. And students have luxury, that choice option in developed countries. We don't have. Countries like India, the family forces force the student to go for engineering, to go for medical, to go for law, professional education, right? That they do. Technical education, engineering education is part of higher education, okay? Higher education could be conventional, professional. Conventional is BA, BSc, BCom, okay? Today, it has not remained that watertight compartment in conventional education and professional education. That's not watertight compartment. Professional education is the one which gains immediate professional hold, profession, job for the graduate. Okay, so engineering, law, medicine, pharmacy, all that, hotel management, whatever comes under purview of AICT and medical things, right? That is architecture, planning. All this is known as professional education, right? Student, they help student to get a job immediately or to start their own business, enterprise, startup, right? BA, BSc, BCom may not be like that. May not be like that, right? But I can claim it's not a hard boundary. Both must target in imparting knowledge, skills, and behavior. That's our aim, no problem. KSA is the aim of both educations, no issues. but conventional education is more philosophical, is more abstract. Okay, more focuses on why do I live on this earth? That kind of philosophy. Purpose of existence of a individual human being as a social element. So outcome is philosophical, qualitative, not that tangible. But professional education more aims at wealthy means and tools for existence of individual as a social element. It directly targets at giving you a job. So job is a way or means of earning money, is it not? Well-being. So it ensures more of well-being. Outcome is therefore tangible and more materialistic. BA, BSc, BCom, performing arts, photography, painting, social sciences, social work, all of them may not get you a job directly. Okay. Again and again, I say, I don't want to blame or undermine the conventional education, not at all. Today, this boundary is vanishing. Good part. Okay. Engineering education should have majority of arts, commerce also into the syllabus. Is it not? Finance, economics, law, IPR, that all should be part of engineering education. Arts, photography, performing arts, all that should be music, filmmaking, all that should be part of engineering education also. So I say boundaries are blurring anyway, right? Some more philosophy, which was evolved by another gentleman. A great educationist known as Bloom, B-L-O-O-M. I came to know about this person only 10, 11 years ago when I first came across outcome-based education, accreditation, right? Bloom was a great educationist philosopher. He says that there are three domains of education. The way I impart education can be imparted in three sections. There should be some challenge, some entry, some input to the brain. There should be some input, some challenge, some delivery to my hands. There should be some challenge, some input, some kind of delivery to heart. See, brain, hand, heart are all organs of human body, right? I want to educate a human. Teacher wants to educate the human, okay? How teacher can do that? He or she, teacher can instigate brain. He can use stimulus or work to hand. He can instigate or stimulate heart, three organs, okay? To the brain generally, teacher should deliver intellectual skills, knowledge. Knowledge is a really a good word, right? Knowledge plays with the intellect. If both teacher and students are intellectual, their IQs are sharp, then teacher instigates, stimulates brain more and student brain grasps the knowledge, okay? I can measure brain's IQ. Intellect can be measured. How much is the IQ of the learner? How much is the IQ of the teacher? All knowledge typically is an intellectual skill that goes into brain of the learner. Okay? And both teacher and students are high IQ, then this delivery, transfer takes place. Good. No problem. Right? Generally in curriculum, we correlate intellectual transfer from teacher to student in terms of theory courses. All theory courses in syllabus, let's say 40 theory courses I have, they all correlate with the knowledge part of it. This is known as cognitive domain as per Bloom. What is cognitive? All of you know about recognition. What is recognize? I recognize you. Means I had some knowledge in front of me. By face, I recognize you. By name, I recognize you. Okay. Cognition is before recognition, right? A new knowledge is transferred to me. It is known as cognition domain, cognitive domain of learning, right? Of educating the things. So brain, knowledge, theory, intellectual skills, cognitive domain. Next is hand. Engineering is all about hands-on, all about learning by doing. So practicals, laboratory, hands-on skill. This is known as psychomotor domain of education. Why psychomotor? Psycho means mind game, motor means movement. Okay, I have to move my hands as per my mind and then grasp or learn hands-on skills, practicals, lab. In our engineering education, in the curriculum of engineering education, I correlate all laboratory courses, practical courses, laboratory assignments, simulations, hardware, software, systems, machines, equipment with hands-on skill. Right now, as per Bloom, this is psychomotor domain. Is it not? There can be a language laboratory in our college. Language laboratory is a communication domain, English, let's say, or Japanese, or German, or let's say Mandarin. Okay, that is also a psychomotor domain. Believe me, because students speak good language. Is it not? Speaking is by mouth, but it's a hands-on skill for them. It is not theoretical knowledge. It is learning by doing and demonstrating. It's a psychomotor domain. And the third domain which Bloom proposed is very, very, very important. Rather, very important. Okay. It is heart education. Heart to heart education. Teacher should have heart. Learner should have heart. And heart to heart transfer, there should be behavioral skill. Attitudinal training. Student should touch heart of the learner. Okay. So it is heart to heart transfer is most tough. Brain to brain transfer, not that tough. Theoretical knowledge I deliver. Hand to hand transfer, good, no problem. Teacher is skilled, students are skilled. He know how to operate oscilloscope, how to operate computer, how to operate MATLAB, and that skill is delivered, no problem. Heart to heart is most difficult, most unmeasurable, most non-tangible, most non-quantifiable. You have good communication skill, you have good writing skills on board, how much students could grasp from your gestures, your behavior, whether you smile in the class, the way you talk, the way you communicate, your command on English, how much they know. That is heart to heart training. Difficult to measure how much they could gain. Okay. But now AICT says us, worldwide authorities in education say us, that every engineering curriculum must have some courses which deal with behavioral skills, attitudinal training. Okay. And therefore I have communication skill in first year, English communication skill. I have set of languages in my curriculum, Japanese, German, etc., etc. I have course on psychology. I have course on humanities. I have course on social sciences. Is it not? I have course on industrial psychology. I have course on personal behavior. I have course on personal management for that sake. Okay. All these are behavioral skills. This Bloom tag, Bloom said, this is affective domain. Affective domain is affecting other people because of your behavior. Great, no? So he was a great philosopher who says us that education can be sectioned, categorized in cognitive domain, psychomotor domain, affective domain. One deals with brain, one deals with hand, one deals with heart, right? One deals with intellectual power, brain to brain transfer, hand to hand transfer, heart to heart transfer. Very nice categorization or classification. This is known as Bloom's taxonomy. Taxonomy is classification, by the way. Okay. Again, come to the philosophy is over now. Again, come to some numbers, hard facts, truths. Engineering education in Indian scenario. We have 23 IITs almost in every state now, almost in every state. 31 NITs in every state. We have NITs. All of you know that, right? We have NIT in every state, even in Northeast, undeveloped part of country also, in Bihar, we have NIT, Jharkhand, Uttarakhand, all of them are NITs, right? Another model government came up with is 25 triple ITs, Indian Institute of Information Technology, right? All there is new model, PPP model. There were some four or five older triple ITs, and now in Maharashtra, we have two triple ITs, triple IT Pune, triple IT Nagpur. Okay, we have two. Seven ISERs. ISERs were on the lines of IISc. I had forgot, there is one IISc also at Bangalore. Okay. Seven ISERs, Indian Institutes for Science, Education and Research. Okay. That is, these are all by birth, by act, by parliamentary act, they are degree awarding elite institutes of national importance. All of you know that. They're institutes of national importance, a special privilege category of institutes. Highly funded by government, that too central government. Sometimes there is a stake of state government, highly funded, 300, 400 acres of campus, rich, rich everywhere. Okay. Entrance is through JEE Mains, JEE Advanced. Tough. Only meritorious students they'll get. But after that, poorer stuff starts. Jokingly, I say. 3400 plus engineering colleges. We have state owned autonomous colleges like COEP, right? We have a big chunk of autonomous colleges also. Out of those 3400 plus colleges, I am not interested in figures, just the numbers are big that I wanted to tell you. Out of them, only 200 colleges are autonomous, academically autonomous, poor state of affairs, right? In Maharashtra, we have only at least from 15-20 engineering colleges which are autonomous. Poor, okay? I have many colleges in the state of Maharashtra, only 15-20 of them are academically autonomous. Believe me, academically autonomous means we are dissociated, detached from our affiliating university. Right? We have freedom, liberty to curriculum, to design our own curriculum, to deliver our own curriculum, to examine our own curriculum. All comes under our purview. So COEP as a mentor college, mentor institute, always advises its mentee institutes to go for autonomy. Freedom is never bad. Freedom is never bad. We have freedom, independence, it is never bad. Okay, go for academic autonomy. There are around 150 private universities. We have in Pune also, MIT, WPU, DY Patil University, VIT University, many are there, right? In South, we have VIT, Beltec University. In Tamil Nadu, we have many universities. Satyabhama University, Hindustan University, Shiv Nadar University, SRM University, many are there, right? And these universities are private universities. They are also struggling. They have to make special attempts to attract students. But believe me, friends, Amity, many are there. In North also many, Belgotias. And then these universities are really coming with some innovative models of curriculum, innovative learning models. They're coming up really. Whereas all IITs, IITs, NITs, they're orthodox. They are orthodox, believe me. Because by default, they get good students, so they're orthodox. In COEP, at COEP, 166 years old institute, we are not IIT, we are not NIT, but we are beyond many NITs, believe me. In NRF ranking, we are beyond many NITs. We are on par with many new IITs and IITs, believe me. We don't have track of IIT, IIIT, but we are beyond them, okay? Because we are never orthodox. We never say that we are great, okay? We do lot of innovations, inventions, discoveries, experiments in our curriculum. What a practice we have in academics also, in curriculum, okay? We are not orthodox and therefore we are changing. Which are regulatory authorities in the country? We have University Grants Commission. All of you know that. It's the highest apex authority body. AICT, our own AICT, it's a statutory regulatory authority body, okay? Which commands and controls and regulates technical education in the country. When I say technical education, it's a professional education. Engineering degree, diploma, postdoc, postgraduate, everything. Okay, then all, like pharmacy and then architecture and then hotel management, everything. They dictate, okay, the terms. Affiliating university, Pune University for our case, Savitribai Phule Pune University, state government, DTE, Higher and Technology Department in state government. They also dictate, regulate, control, command, all they do. Okay, regulation in country is quite tight in India. Okay, in US it is not. It is regulated education which we impart. But then we should be free from the clutches of these regulatory authorities. National New Education Policy 2020 is going to promote, propagate, advocate this all liberty from the clutches of regulatory authority. Now all these regulatory authorities will be more or less empowering, facilitating authorities, not regulating. That is the dream now, which has to come true. Okay. Access, equity, and inclusivity are principles of social justice. They are jotted down in the constitution. Okay. But then access to education everywhere. Rural part, Mofussil part, remote part, hilly part, whatever. Okay. All of them should have access to education everywhere. This is true today. True. Every corner, nook and corner of country, we have engineering college. Equity, race equity, caste equity, breed equity, gender equity. We do not discriminate. Everybody and anybody should get right to education. Inclusivity. All sections of society are included in the education. Equal right to education. No problem. Okay? They're applied to higher education and its growth. initially there was focus on gross enrollment ratio, GER. And therefore, 20 years ago, privatization of education in the country started in 1980, in mid 80s, let's say. Okay. In Maharashtra, it started in 1983, Vasandaga Patil time, right? It started. And AICT went on giving, in 90s, AICT went on giving permissions to start many, many new engineering colleges, because the focus was enrollment ratio to engineering colleges should have increased. Gross enrollment ratio, okay? That was to be increased. So they kept on giving permissions to engineering colleges one after the other. But that gross enrollment ratio soon proved to be swelling. Swelling, it was not true growth. The G was not for growth. It was not healthy growth. It was all swelling, believe me, that proved to be. And there was diversity on all fronts. Quality of students intake went on deteriorating. Today also, do not get good students. No? Good quality intake students you don't get. Teachers quality, your quality, my quality is really very, very important. Okay, how if the management doesn't pay you good salary, 7 pay scale as per AICT, how can you dedicate your all things to management? Cannot, right? So teachers should be motivated, well knowledgeable, updating, lifelong learners they should be. That will happen only when everything is good. Infrastructure resources, does my management invest in infrastructure equipment, computers, library, internet? Do they do that? Do I have good classrooms, fans, AC everywhere, good seminars? Do I have that? And ultimately diversity on all fronts, like mindset of everybody, mindset of my board of governors, mindset of management people, mindset of teachers, mindset of parents, mindset of students. Everything is diversified in country like ours. We are 150 crores, 140 crores, and we have lot of diversity. So to drive this elephant education system, huge task really, take it from me, okay? But systems are moving, we move, is it not? There is dynamism always, we move. Curriculum, let's come to the topic of my session, all was a background preparation. But as a teacher, as an administration of teacher, I should have told you this information, I told you. It was all motivational information. Come to curriculum. Quality of imparted engineering education is primarily dependent on and decided by, that I feel, many of us feel, decided by teaching learning examination. TLE, teaching learning assessment examination. I feel that, many of us feel that. But TLE in turn depends on. What is aim of education? Knowledge, skill, attitudinal imparting. I have to deliver knowledge through theory courses. I have to deliver skills through lab courses. I have to deliver behavioral training through courses or otherwise, informally, right? That is through teaching learning examination. But all this depends on a nicely designed curriculum, elegantly designed curriculum, okay? It depends the way after I design curriculum, a teacher delivers the curriculum in classroom, in lab, formally, informally, outside classroom, outside lab. Then you interact with the student, okay? And after that, you give the examination to students, assessment, take their oral, give them a 60 marks paper, 100 marks paper, quiz, assignment, everything. Quality of TLE depends on quality of designed curriculum, contents of curriculum, contents of syllabus, certainly depends more on how do we deliver. How do we impart? Does a teacher have command on the way he or she teaches the student? Command on subject content, command on the way he delivers, command on communication skill. Does he have that? That's a way. Okay. And how good? We are ethical. We are innovative in setting examination paper. What is the quality of my assignment? What is quality of my lab assignment? What is quality of my quiz? What is quality? Where is quality of my examination? Very, very important, right? And therefore our session should focus upon curriculum design and delivery, CDD. So all those acronyms, no, I say I can accumulated them. Knowledge, skill, attitude, teaching, learning, assessment, curriculum design delivery. These three terms are takeaway terms for you. After I leave you with this thought, what you should carry, impress on your brain and mind is KSA, TLA, CD and D. That's all, right? What is curriculum design and delivery? What is that? Design and development and delivery. What do I do? It's an inclusive process. I have to really take into account all. All means teachers who teach the course, students who learn the course. Both must be taken into account. Both must be taken into account to deliver, to design the curriculum. That this course, devices course, VLSI design course, simulation course, MATLAB course, internship course, for that sake, project course, mini project course, humanities course, language course. I have to take into account opinions of all. Basically, opinions of teacher and learner. Then opinion of industry, corporate, alumni. Whether English communication skill course was really useful for the alumni who passed out, take their opinion. Okay? Does industry find some kind of substance if I introduce a course on Python programming? Or they're happy with data structures? What? Take into account industry, corporate opinion also. So see to it that you have inclusive process to be executed with tremendous responsibility. I am grooming my students' future. Believe me, it's a tremendous responsibility and accountability. It is not a time pass exercise, not at all. It is outcome of deep philosophy, thought process, very mature thought process of experts. It is job of actually board of studies, is it not? Who designs curriculum for us? Board of studies. Board of studies is a group of people, team of people who are true experts. We have industry experts, we have corporate experts, we have IIT professors, we have experts which are taken from by election or selection or nomination. We have experts on board of studies from domain of that branch, domain of electronics. We have board of studies in electronics, board of studies in computer, board of studies in mechanical. So we accumulate all such experts. They are deep philosophers, they have mature thought process. It's a systematic and scientific problem to be attempted with a caution and care. At COEP, I coined one term. I was Dean Academics earlier, and I had a privilege to design, give a curriculum structure for two iterations of curriculum revision, 2015 and 2019. Every 4 years in COEP, we revise curriculum, every 4 years, right? In 2015 and 2019, curriculum was laid by me, architected by me, basically with my team, right? I define curriculum design and development as a complex optimization problem. It's a truly scientific problem because I have to take into recognize cognition of trends in technology. I do not cannot leave fundamental science courses. I cannot leave fundamental branch specific courses. I cannot leave them. They are to be there, but technology advances. It is on horizon. I have to include those courses. I have to strike a balance between behavioral, theory, lab, everything. All that is to be balanced out nicely. It's an optimization problem, therefore I say. Right? No, optimization, balancing problem, to be attempted with caution and care. Okay? And this whole curriculum design development process aims at, concludes at, a document known as curriculum structure. It's a tabular structure. Okay, all of you know what is curriculum structure. I have a course, course code, course name, then teaching scheme. How many credits this course has? Lecture, tutorial, practical, lab, that's the teaching scheme, examination scheme. I have two INSEM examinations, quizzes, 2020, INSEM examination, right? For 60, that is all part of curriculum structure. All of you know that, right? What are the driving factors and challenges? Today, an electronics and telecommunication, or electronics and communication branch specific curriculum I have to design. No problem. It must be domain specific. It must be branch specific. No problem. But national, international, local forces force me to go for bringing in interdisciplinary component. People are at the top are of the opinion that all branches are merging. There is no perfect kind of a watertight compartment between mechanical and electronics, electronics and production, production and computer, computer and industrial. Okay, industrial and electrical, no watertight compartment. All branches need knowledge from other branches. That's the way. So I have to also have a strong interdisciplinary component. So problem becomes complex, right? No, curriculum design is not a simple problem. It's a complex problem. Thin, but perfect balance among diversified courses. I have to have many, many courses. Humanity course, social science course, language course, lab course, project course, mini project course, internship course, group discussion course, seminar, core course, elective course, department elective, open elective, what not. So many diversified courses, I have to maintain the balance. Alignment with pace of technology. We say every 2, 3, 4 years, technology changes. Big part is learner's mindset. Learners, which we get today, is millennium population, born after 2000. Is it not? They have all resources, sources on the on their fingertips, in their mobile. Teachers do not teach them. They don't need teachers to teach them. Okay? Teachers should be value adders. Teachers should be facilitators. If they can take a course on digital signal processing from Professor Gadre of IIT Bombay, who's authority in the country in signal processing, why they will learn from me? Professor Sutarna is a signal processing teacher in COEP. But if students have access for an NPTEL course of Professor Gadre, who's authority in the country, why they will learn from me, right? Those aspirations, mindsets are changing. For that sake, they have actually international professors are at their fingertips. International, Coursera, edX, MIT, Stanford, Carnegie Mellon, all of them are going to teach them online, available. So what is the mindset changing? Okay, virtual labs are available. Teachers' learning curves. Teachers are quite orthodox. They are not ready to learn. I blame you and me. We do not keep our learning curves ever sharp. We should be dynamic. We should be lifelong learners first, right? Then only we can inspire students to take learning from us. And there is framework by regulatory authority, right? No, AICT says make the 6 weeks induction program. Go for 6 weeks internship in second year, third year, summer. All those are imposed by AICT. UGC says learn Vedas, learn Indian culture, learn that ancient Indian knowledge, keep all those languages. Okay, they force us. Constitution of India, they force us. Why should I be interested in learning something from Vedic mathematics? I may not be, but they force us because UGC tells us like that, framework by regulatory authorities. Industry corporate expectation for employability. Industry corporate want all branches should have machine learning, all branches should have data science, all branches should have artificial intelligence, all branches should have Python programming. That is their expectation, is it not? Can I do that? Can I do that? It's a complex optimization problem. Can I do that? Preparing learners for opportunities in higher education, entrepreneurship, job. Job is by default, no problem. Can I really prepare my, through my curriculum design and delivery, can I prepare my student for opportunities in higher education? MTech, MS, MBA, whatever they do, right? Can I do that? Can I inspire, motivate them to go for their own startup? Why to always seek for job? Can I do that? Curriculum design also has got this focus, this objective. Believe me, there are many, many driving factors and challenges, really many. Learners should be globally competent and locally relevant. This is today's this thing, right? Today, people expect that learners should be globally competent. He should do a job in Netherlands, okay? Because TCS has an office in Netherlands. When he goes to Netherlands, he should learn local language, local mannerism. That is behavioral training. Believe me, he may be deputed in China. And then if he knows Japanese language or Mandarin language in China and Japan, he'll be more acceptable. That is the way. Also, it should be locally relevant, that I always tell. Another major guiding force is whatever I mentioned, no, initially, outcome-based education. Program outcomes, which are competency profiles, graduate attributes, okay? Knowledge and competency profile. this should be demonstrable. Visibly, a learner at the end of taking program from college, he or she should be able to demonstrate to the world that he or she has acquired sufficient engineering science knowledge. Okay, he or she should be able to demonstrate, look at that word, demonstrate, prove to the external world, to the corporate, to the industry, to the society, that he or she as a student has gained, acquired sufficient engineering science knowledge. Engineering is all about problem solving. Do you know that? Engineers are problem solvers. First of all, they are problem sensors. They should be able to sense the problem, define the problem, design the problem, investigate the problem, research the problem, explore the problem, literature the problem, all of that. All engineering science problem, they should analyze and then provide the solution, right? No? So problem analysis, design, development of solution, investigation, through all their education and research, college should inculcate all these qualities in the learner. How do they do that? How do they tackle the problem, solve the, provide the solution? Through modern tool usage. Tools are platforms, hardware, software, simulation, equipment, machinery, computers, everything. All that is tool. All that modern technological tool they should use and see to it that they gain all the skills and knowledge through problem analysis, etc. First five are completely technical graduate attributes. But hereafter, engineer in society. Is my engineering graduate socially accountable? Socially responsible? Does he have sensitivity towards environment? Let's say rain harvesting, rainwater harvesting, solar panels in this, right? How to use non-conventional energy? Does he or she put the lights, electricity off after he leaves the lab? Does he do that? That is environmental sensitivity, right? Conservation of water energy, sustainable environment. Is he professionally ethical? Is he professionally ethical? Required in industry, corporate, it is required. He, she should be professionally ethical. We now have mockery of this thing, right? We have course on professional ethics. We teach them when they go to work in the industry or corporate, when they behave in team, how they should ethically behave. We have a course for it, right? It doesn't guarantee that professional ethics course is passed by the student with good grades, he or she will be ethical. Okay, ethics is all unmeasurable quality of human mind. Right? No, I cannot ask a person to be ethical. It is all questioning inner mind. That's all. Okay. How good he is as an individual communicator. How is good? Does he gel with the team? Because projects here, problems have to be solved in a team, not individually in industry, right? Can he contribute to team? Can he gel with the team? Or is he very orthogonal to the team? What? Does he have good communication skill? Does he or she communicate effectively? Does he speak well, manners well? Does he write well? Does he have good presentation skill? Does he produce good draft document? All that is communication. And above all, because engineering system process development is a problem which is a project, every student must have knowledge of project management, demonstrable knowledge of project management and finance. Okay, all our board of governors at COEP, they comprise of big shots in industry and corporate. Okay, we have now Padma Shri Pratap Rao Pawar, who is a big industrialist. Okay, and he is our BOG chairman now. He says in engineering, after engineering graduate passes out and he or she wants to start up his, go for his business, enterprise, entrepreneurship, then he has, she or she should have only 20-30% knowledge of science, technology, engineering. The rest is all finance and economics. Accounts, believe me, okay, finance. So every engineer must be also knowledgeable about finance. We have courses now on finance, economics, accounts, etc. We have courses on project management. And one of the most prominent things in program outcomes is all about
Sir, Sutone, sir, please unmute yourself. Sir, unmute yourself.
Yes. I had a phone call. Sorry for that.
Yes, sir. You are audible now. You are audible, please.
Lifelong learning is a graduate attribute. Means what? Today's technology will tomorrow obsolete. Is it not? So on their own, I should really imbibe a quality in my students to make them lifelong learners. Right? This is a property. All program outcomes which are envisaged and given to the world by outcome-based education, all these are also a major guideline for designing curriculum. Friends, take it from me like that. Okay? That's the way. Which is regulatory framework in the country for curriculum design and development? MHRD. Now this is known as Ministry of Education. MHRD has one body, apex body, UGC. UGC keeps on releasing, issuing guidelines to their gazette notifications for how to design curriculum. They keep on doing that. Every year they do that. For higher education, they do that. AICT is also, it also comes under Ministry of Education. It's apex regulatory facilitating authority. And AICT also releases quite frequently, after every 5-6 years, they release a guideline known as AICT model curriculum. This becomes a major guideline for us. Then there are professional societies, bodies, IEEE, International Organization in Electrical Electronics Engineering, right? We have this professional society-like body, IEEE, in our domain, Electrical Electronics domain. There is ACM. Okay, ACM is an international body in computer machinery, computer domain. CSI is an Indian body, professional society, Computer Society of India. Indian Institute of Engineers in India, IEI. It is Indian Institute, right? Then there are bodies like CII, industry body, Confederation of Indian Industry. Okay, we have body like FICCI, Federation of Indian Commerce and something, right? That is, these are industrial bodies. All of them release a roadmap of technology in the future. They release every year, every 2 years, they release a guideline, technology roadmap, future of technology. And that is also to be cognized, taken into account while designing curriculum. Because there's a future roadmap for the technology. All of them give you. Okay. And in affiliation model, we are affiliated to, let's say, Pune University, SPPU. They will give you curriculum to be delivered. No problem. Right. But ultimately, how effectively we design the curriculum, how effectively we are going to deliver the curriculum. That all depends on whom? Depends on assessors. There are accrediting agencies in the country. National Board of Accreditation and National Accreditation and Assessment Council, NAC. They are the end bodies actually. They judge the quality of curriculum design, development, delivery. Okay, but the accreditation guidelines, the self-assessment SAR formats, they also dictate the way curriculum should be designed, developed and delivered. Is it not? This is regulatory framework for me. All this is regulatory framework for me, right? There is a flow chart. What is the process? Who does it? Actually, ideally, this is a flow chart. I should collect needs and aspirations of all stakeholders. Who are the stakeholders in particular? Students who learn the curriculum, teachers who impart the curriculum. Is it not? And who are other stakeholders? Industry, corporate mainly. Okay, because they're customers of our students, end customers of our students. I should collect needs and aspirations of all of them. First, I should do that. I should also naturally surrender myself to technology trends, global technology trends, local technology trends. All I should really collect, gather. I should analyze. Once I gather all these needs and aspirations, I should analyze. Analysis always gives me some good amount of inference and conclusions. I should do that first of all, then design and develop the curriculum structure, tabular curriculum structures, 40 theory courses, 20 lab courses, one micro project, one mini project, one main project, one internship, one induction program, like that. Okay, all that design development of structure I should carry. These many credit courses, these many audit courses, that's the way. Particular course carries these many credits, per semester these many credits, that's the way. Okay. All that I should develop. And then there is a course subject terminology is now gone. curriculum structure is group. It is a collection of courses, theory courses, elective courses, lab courses, a course which is delivered, right? After that, I deliver course, I design course-wise syllabus. I should take help of some expert teacher group. Let's say signal sense system is a course. Signal processing is a course. Python programming is a course. Data set is a course. So let us take course-wise expert with me and detail out the syllabus, unit-wise, module-wise, 5 units, 6 units, whatever, okay? And then start implementing. Deliver the content of the syllabus, examine the content, give the examination, decide examination pattern, do all that, okay? Then take its review. Feedback is most important. How well my syllabus of the course was digested? Whether students could score? Was it very difficult? There is a feedback mechanism. All of us take student feedback. How good they could grasp, okay? Whether curriculum was tough for them, for their IQ, their brain game, was it tough or what? After I take review, I keep on repeating this cycle. It's a closed loop. I should keep on doing this. So there is a typical curriculum review, curriculum revision frequency. Every 4 years, I do that. Every 4 years in COEP, I do that. When I was with, I'm still with Savitribai Phule Pune University, I insist them to do it every 4 years. Why 4 years? Because the same curriculum structure should be prevailing, should be applicable for that those passing out batch. Is it not? For those passing out batches who entered in this year, and that should be therefore applicable to those kind of stuff over there, right? That should happen. Hello. नाही राहू दे, नको नको, तिथूनच करा. ओके हो येस ओके ओके अँड दिस प्रोसेस देन आय हॅड अ फोन कॉल अगेन सो माय मीटिंग टाइम स्टार्ट नाव एनी वे ऍडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव्ह मीटिंग आर स्टार्टिंग सो आय विल बी कन्क्लुडिंग नाव. So this is the last slide of today's session. I have to continue session tomorrow also. And this takes place, right? In university, Board of Studies does this job. In COEP also, we have department-wise, branch-wise, Board of Studies, right? I'll take your leave for today now, and I'll continue with this tomorrow. So Dr. Hivrekar was kind enough with Dr. Patil to give me a tomorrow's slot, Saturday. It is Saturday, it's a holiday for me. So I'm away from my administrative business. Okay, today I have a meeting scheduled at 11 o'clock. Therefore, there were calls one after the other, right? So I'll stop here and take your leave. And then I'll leave you with this thought, which 3333 I said, KSA, TLA, Curriculum Design Development Delivery, CDDD, all are triplets, is it not? I leave you with that thought. I will not, cannot take questions now because I don't have time now. Sorry for that. Tomorrow, yes, I'll spend some more time with you.
Yes, sir. Yes, we will have questions in tomorrow's session, sir. No issue.
Tomorrow's session, right.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your time, sir. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so please continue with your meeting. Yeah.
I have to leave the meeting now.
Okay, yes, sir. No problem, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Patil, sir.
Sir, bola.
We will arrange a photo session of all participants.
All the participants. Please switch on your camera. We can have a photograph. Though we do not have the guest right now, we can have the photograph with all the participants. Okay, learned and all intelligent participants. Please, all participants, please start your camera. Thank you. Rest of you, please start your camera. All the participants, please switch on your camera.